tutorial series of the operating system. I am your instructor Varshata. Let's start our lecture series. Topics that are going to cover in today's lecture, that is operating system structure. So today we will learn about the different types of operating system structure. So which are the different operating system structure? So here you can see these are the names of the different operating system structure. As we have seen the monolithic kernel and microkernel when we have discussed about the what is the kernel and which are the different types of the kernel. So at that time we have discussed this two type, that is a monolithic kernel and microkernel. And today we will see the another type of the operating system structure, that is a layered approach, then client server model and the virtual machine. Okay, so let's start with this. So first of all, layered approach. Okay, so the operating system is split into the various layer in the layered operating system, and each of the layers have the different functionalities. Got it? Operating system is designed as a way so we can divide, we can define the different functionality for each and every layer. So here you can see these are the layer technology. One layer is for the user purpose, another is for the process management, then another layer is for the CPU scheduling, then innermost layer is for the hardware purpose, then memory management, and then input output buffer. Okay, so these are the layer technology. Your entire operating system is divided according to the functionality it provides. Okay, so let's have a look at each and every layer in detail. So here you can see, first layer is a hardware. It is the innermost layer. So what is the responsibility of this hardware layer? So here you can see this layer is the interact, this layer interact with the system hardware and the coordinates with the all the peripheral devices used such as a printer, mouse, keyboard, scanner, etc. So whenever we have to contact with any peripheral devices, whenever we have to work with any peripheral devices like the printer, keyboard, etc. So at that time this hardware layer will be used. For example, you are giving the print of the any of the document. So at that time this hardware layer used to connect that printer to our computer system. Got it? Now next is the CPU scheduling. So CPU, what is the CPU scheduling? This layer deals with the scheduling of the processes. There are numbers of processes that are running in your computer system. Okay, so at that time we have to arrange these processes. Which process will go for the execution, which process will wait, and which process in the job queue. So we have to set everything. So here you can see there are two types of queue, job queue and ready queue. Job queue, that means what? When the process enters in the system, at that time that process will placed in the job queue. And when the process is ready for execution, at that time that process will be kept in the ready queue. So this is the work of the CPU. So the CPU scheduling possibilities, CPU scheduling functionalities will be provided by this layer. Now next is the memory management. So memory management deals with the memory and moving of the processes from disk to the primary memory for the executions. Okay, so this is handled by the third layer of the operating system. So it's provide all the memory management functionality. So using that memory management functionality, it's provide the primary memory allocation for each and every processes. Now next is the process management. Okay, so process management, that means what? Which process will go for the execution first? Which process will go for the execution based on the priority? Which process will be executed for some time durations? So these are the different types of algorithm that is used for the process scheduling. So process scheduling will be done using such type of algorithm. Here you can see on the screen, that is FCFS, SJF, priority scheduling, round robin algorithm. So this algorithm we will see in next upcoming lecture. So FCFS, that means first come first serve. The process which come first for the execution, so that will be served first. Okay, so that is what FCFS. Then SJFS, shortest job first. The least execution time, So first priority of that process for the execution. So likewise, these are the different types of algorithm that is used for the process scheduling. Now next is the input output buffer. Okay, so this layer handles the buffer for the input output devices and it makes sure that they work correctly. Okay, so it maintains the input output buffer. So when any data comes from the disk drive, it will store in that buffer, and from that buffer the user can access the data. So all this functionality will be done by the input output buffer. Now next is the user program. Okay, so this layer is the highest layer in the layered operating system. So using this layer, any end user can interact with your operating system and do some specific task. Okay, so this user program is the highest layer of the operating system structure in the layered approach. Now what are the advantages of this layered approach? So here you can see the first is the modularity. That means each layer performs only the task that is assigned to it, or only it performs that particular scheduled task only. Now next is easy debugging. All the layers are discrete, so it is very easy to debug. So if there is any error in a particular functionality, we have to deal with that particular layer only. Then next is the easy update. A modification made in a particular layer will not affect the other system, because again it is a layer technology and each and every layers are different. No direct access to the hardware, so we can protect the hardware from any unauthorized access, from any changing in the hardwares. So we can protect it because there is a no direct access to the hardware when we are using the layer technology. Then abstractions. Every layer is concerned with its own function, so the functions and implementation of the other layers are abstract to it. Okay, so this type of this advantage is provided by the layer technology. Now which are the disadvantages of the layer technology? So first disadvantage is what? Complex and careful implementation. Why? Because it is a ultimately layer technology, so we have to define the layer carefully. For example, the backing storage layer use the services of the memory management, so you should have to cap that layer below the memory management layer. Okay, so it can access the functionality of the memory management layer. So carefully you have to define the layer. So that is one of the disadvantages of the layered approach. Now next disadvantage, it is slower in execution. Why slower in execution? Because numbers of layers are there. So if lower layer want to communicate with the higher layer, then that request will pass through the all the layer and response will come through the all the layers. Okay, so if there are numbers of layers, so complications will be high. Okay, so thus increasing the numbers of layers may lead to the very inefficient design. So this is also the one disadvantage. So it slow down the execution of the process. Now next is a monolithic kernel, that also we have discussed in the last lecture when we have seen the kernel and different types of the kernel. So what is the monolithic kernel? Here the operating system and the kernel both are run in the same memory. There is no any different space for kernel and the operating system. So that is known as the monolithic kernel. Here you can see this figure represents the monolithic kernel. Here in kernel space and all the functionalities are there, so through which user system can access. Now what are the advantages and disadvantages of these monolithic kernel? Advantages, it provides the CPU scheduling, memory scheduling, file management through system calls only. Okay, and disadvantages is what? If any services fails, then it leads to the system failure, because both are implemented in the same service. And another disadvantage is what? If you want to change the any functionality in the kernel, you have to modify the entire kernel. So this is what the disadvantage of the monolithic kernel, and these disadvantage will be overcome in the microkernel. Now here next third type of operating system structure is a microkernel. A microkernel is a different form of the monolithic kernel, Because in a microkernel, the user services and the kernel services are implemented into the different space. Okay, so here, for example, we use the user space and kernel space in the case of the microkernel. So as we use the user space and kernel space separately, it reduces the size of the kernel. Okay, in monolithic kernel, we are implementing at this same space, but here we are dividing the space. So kernel size will be smaller in the microkernel. So here we can see this figure gives the view of the microkernel. Now, what are the advantage and disadvantage of the microkernel? Advantage is what? It is more stable. Why? Because each and every functionality that is implemented in user space, only the using the system call we can access that functionality using the kernel. The architecture of this kernel is small and isolated, hence its function better. Okay, and expansion of the system is easier because we are not implementing the all the functionality in the kernel space. So if you want to change the any functionality, if you want to modify or if we want to extend the kernel functionality, then it will be very easy in this microkernel. What are the disadvantage? System calls will be more and more because we are implementing the functionality in the user space. So every time we require the system call to access this functionality. Now next type is a client server model. So what is client server model? Basically the client server model, that means what? Client want some information. So client will query and server will reply. Okay, so this is what the client server model. For example, if you want to search anything on the Google search engine, what you will do? You will just type that particular keyword. For example, you want to search for the operating system structure. So you will type the operating system structure in a Google search engine. You will give the enter. It will give the numbers of response to you. So this is one of the example of the client server model. The server that is located will search according to the keyword that you have provided in that particular search engine. So according to the indexing, it will provide all the details on your page. So this is what one type of client server example. Here you can see client will query to the server and server will retrieve that particular data and it will give the response back to the client. So this is what client server model. Now how this client server model works? So first of all, what is client and what is server? So client, that means when we talk the word client, it means to talk of a person or an organization using the particular service. So when I am going to search about the operating system structure, so I will be the client. Got it? Whenever you are going to search anything about any information, then you will be a client. Got it? Similarly, in the digital world, a client is a computer or a host. For example, capable of receiving the information or using the particular service from the service providers. So your machine, through that machine, you are going to search and information will be provided by the server. So your machine will work as a client machine because you are using that particular machine for getting the services. Now next is, what is server? Okay, so similarly, when we talk the word server, it means a person or a medium that serves something. Okay, similarly, in this digital world, server is a remote computer which provides the information or access to that particular service. Okay, so basically we can say that basically the client is requesting something and server is replying something. Okay, serving as long as the database is present. So at that time, server can reply if there is a database of that particular information. So now all of you are aware about what is client and what is server. Now here you can see this figure represent the client server model. Client is requesting whether it is your laptop, whether it is your mobile device or whether it is your desktop service. Through internet we are requesting the server and server will reply back to the client machine. Now which are the advantages of the client server model? So first advantage, it is a centralized system with all the data at a single place. Then second is what? A cost efficient, requires less maintenance cost, and data recovery is possible when we are using the client server model. We can replicate the databases. So it is possible if one database fails, we can use another database. Then the capability of the client and server can be changed separately. Okay, you can change the capability of client as well as server. So these are the advantages of the client server model. Now, which are the disadvantages of the client server model? First, clients are the prone to viruses, trojans and worms if it is present in the server. So whenever client is going to request, that will be received by the client as a response. Then another is the servers are prone to the denial of service attack. Someone who is executing numbers of requests, who is an attacker, so it executing the numbers of requests, or it may provide the it may give the number of traffic in the network system. So what will happen? Server will not able to provide the services to the any client because of this so much traffic. So this type of attack is also possible. So that is for the denial of service attack. Then next, data packets may be spoofed or modified during the transmission. So whenever you are requesting something, it may be possible your request will be interfered by the another third person, and it will modify that request and will send to the client, send to the server, and server will reply back to according to the modified request. Okay, so your request may be spoofed. Then phishing or capturing login credentials or other useful informations of the users are common. And man-in-middle attack also possible in the client-server model. So these are the disadvantages. So for that we have to implement the more security features for this disadvantage of the client-server model. Now last is the virtual machine. Now what is virtual machine? I think all of you are aware about this virtual machine. You may have installed the virtual box in your system. So at the same time you are able to execute, for example, Windows as well as the Linux. So you have the Windows as a primary system, primary operating system. Now you want to use the Linux as an operating system. So at the same time, what you will do, you will install the virtual box, and in that virtual box, you are executing the Linux operating system. So whenever you are executing the Linux operating system, any person have the illusion that we are executing the Linux operating system in this machine. Okay, so you, that person or that client will not think that this is the operating system in a virtual box. So the meaning of saying this virtual machine is what? That we virtual machine creates the illusion. Okay, so the illusions that someone think that they are using that particular devices, and that is dedicated to that particular person only. So this effect is provided by the virtual machine. So it is known as the virtual machine. Okay, so here you can say when we run the different processes on the operating system, it creates an illusions that each process is running on the different processors having its own virtual memory. So with the help of the CPU scheduling and virtual memory techniques, so it creates one illusion. So it defines that each and every processes has its own memory space, its own virtual memory. So this concept is provided by the virtual machine. Here you can see this is the virtual, three different types of virtual machine implemented on a born system. Here a main infrastructure is there. Here it is provided the hypervisor. So this hypervisor is what? It's provide the functionality to execute the numbers of virtual machine, numbers of different illusions on your main system. Here you can see the virtual machine for application A, for virtual machine for application B, and virtual machine for application C. So here the operating system which we are executing on the main system, that is known as the guest operating system. Now which are the advantages? Advantages, there are no protection problem because each virtual machine is completely isolated from the another virtual machine. Okay, so different virtual machines are there for the different operating system or for any functionality that you want to execute. Okay, so protection problem is not there. Virtual machines can provide an instruction set architecture that differs from the real computers, and it is easy for the maintenance, availability and convenient recovery is there in the virtual machine. Now which are the disadvantages? When multiple virtual machines are simultaneously running on the host computer and one virtual machine can be affected by the other running virtual machine, then depending on the workload. Okay, so it happens workload is divided, so maybe one virtual machine works as slower. Virtual machines are not as efficient as real one when accessing the hardware. Ultimately, it is a virtual machine, so it is not efficient as accessing the original operating system. Now, summary of today's lecture, we have learned about the operating system structure, in which we have seen the different types of operating system structure, that is a layered approach, monolithic kernel, micro kernel, client server model and virtual machine. So this is all about this lecture. Remaining interesting topic we will cover in the next lecture. Thank you for watching. We will meet in the next lecture. Thank you.